In this video, we will go for the helicopter, how it flies and what is happening in the flight. The helicopter, one of the most versatile and useful aircraft for a wide variety of application, is the helicopter. The word helicopter is derived from the two Greek words helix, meaning spiral, and pterios, meaning wing. Hence, we may say that a helicopter has a spiral-like or rotating wing. The rotating wing, or in bracket main rotor, of a helicopter has two or more blades depending upon the design and size of the helicopter. Each blade is an airfoil having a profile similar to that of an airplane wing. The same laws of aerodynamics that apply to other airfoils apply to the helicopter rotor blades. The great usefulness of the helicopter is due to its ability to fly straight up, sideways, forward or backward, or remain still in a hovering position. Because of its ability to land in almost any small clear area, the helicopter is used for air taxi service, police work, intercity mail and passenger service, power line patrolling, construction work, firefighting, agricultural work, air sea rescue, and a variety of other services. The idea of the helicopter was conceived as early as 1483, when Leonardo da Vinci made a sketch of a flying machine having a large helical type wing. The machine was never built, but it clearly indicated the idea of a vertical flight. One of the first truly successful machines was the Autogiro, designed and built by Juan de la Clerva. Spanish aircraft designer. The Autogiro has a free rotor that turns as the result of airflow. The forward thrust of this machine is produced by the conventional engine and propeller. As a result of the many experiments conducted by various designers, we now have the modern and effective helicopter such as the one shown in the figure. Helicopter flight. The helicopter flies in accordance with the same laws of aerodynamics that govern the flight of a conventional airplane. In the helicopter, however, these laws are applied differently. The helicopter is subject to the same four forces that affect other aircraft, that is, lift, weight, thrust, and drag. Lift supports the weight of the aircraft, and thrust overcomes drag and moves the aircraft in the direction desired. The principle of lift in a helicopter can be easily demonstrated with a small propeller rotated by means of a spool with two holding pins mounted on a handle as shown in this figure. A string wound around the spool serves to rotate the spool at a high speed and thus spin the propeller. As the propeller generates lift, it rises from the holding pins and flies into the air. As I mentioned previously, a helicopter can fly in any direction with reference to the heading. For example, the helicopter can be headed north and flying south, east, west, or other directions. Furthermore, it can move straight up or straight down, or it can remain stationary when the helicopter is in stationary flight. It is said to be hovering. If the helicopter is hovering in a no-wind condition, the plane of rotation of the rotor or tip path plane is horizontal or parallel with the level ground. During hovering, the sum of the lift and thrust of the helicopter is equal to the sum of the weight and drag. This is illustrated in this figure. During vertical flight, when the sum of the lift and thrust is greater than the sum of the weight and drag, the helicopter will rise. If the sum of the weight and drag is greater than the sum of the lift and thrust, the helicopter will descend. For forward, rearward, or sideward flight, the tip of the plane of the rotor must be tilted to the direction in which is desired to fly. The condition for various types of horizontal flight are illustrated in this figure. Flying forward, the tip path plane of the rotor is tilted forward as shown in the illustrations. The forces of flight are resolved into vertical and horizontal components. If the helicopter is flying forward in a straight and level path, the thrust is equal to the two or greater than the drag in the horizontal direction, and the lift is equal to the weight in the vertical direction. When the helicopter is flying rearward, sideward, or any other horizontal direction, the thrust is acting in forward direction in which the vehicle is moving, and the drag is acting in the opposite direction. Lift and weight is weight always acts in the vertical direction. Now, condition affecting rotor operation. The spinning main rotor of an called a rotor beam is subject to a number of special conditions that must be given consideration in the design of a helicopter. Among these are dissymmetry of lift, gyroscopic precision, centrifugal force, torque, and Coriolis effect. Dissymmetry of lift occurs when the helicopter is in the horizontal flight and is caused by the difference in airspeed over the advancing rotor blades and the retreating rotor blades, assuming that the tip speed of the rotor blade is 350 knots in bracket 180 meter per second and the helicopter is flying in a forward direction at 100 knots in bracket 51.44 meter per second, that is in bracket 2 airspeed. The tip of the rotor blade that is at the position perpendicular to the flight path of the right part on the right side of the helicopter will be moving through the air at 450 knot, that is in bracket 231.48 meter per second, and the tip of the rotor blade on the opposite side will be moving through the air at 250 knot in bracket 128.6 meter per second. It is obvious that the blade on the right side will produce more lift than the blade on the left side if both have the same angle of attack, that is in bracket pitch. Now I am giving a figure which illustrates the effect of horizontal flight on the lift of the individual rotor blades. It will be noted that the condition of hovering flight in still air requires equal lift of both sides of the rotor disc as it does for all level flight. Dissymmetry of lift is compensated by the design of the rotor, which permits blade flapping, and by the design of the cyclic pitch control system. An articulated rotor is designed with hinges at the root of each blade, which permits the blade to move up and down. When the helicopter is flying horizontally, the increased lift on an advancing blade causes it to flap up. The upward movement of the blade reduces the angle of attack because the relative wind direction with respect to the blade is more downward than before. This, of course, decreases the lift of the blade. At the same time, the retreating blade of the rotor flap downward, thus producing a greater angle of attack and increased lift. The combined effect of decreased lift on the advancing blade and increased lift on the retreating blade tends to equalize the lift on the two sides of the rotor disc. A semi-rigid rotor is not hinged at the hub, but the hub itself can tilt as required to produce the flapping action. Thus, as the advancing blade flaps up, the retreating blade flaps downward. The design of the cyclic pitch control also is such that it decreases the angle of attack of the advancing blade and increases the angle of attack of the retreating blade. The total effect is to make the lift of one side of the rotor equal to the lift of the other side. In studying the effect of forward aircraft speed, on the helicopter rotor, it becomes obvious that there is a limit of speed beyond which the helicopter cannot fly. As the forward speed of the helicopter increases, the relative wind velocity on the rotating rotor blade decreases. At a certain relative wind velocity, the rotating blade will stall owing to the high angle of attack. The blade required to maintain lift equal to that of advancing blade. The stall begins at the tip of the blade and works inward as forward speed increases. When this occurs, the helicopter will roll or fall off towards the stalled rotating rotor blade. Helicopters are placarded for maximum never exceed in bracket V small AC below that speed to warn the pilot. Now gyroscopic precision. It is a dynamic force that affects any rotating unit depending upon the mass, diameter and speed of rotation of the unit. Since the rotation of a helicopter has a relatively large diameter and turns a several hundred revolutions per minute, precision is a prime factor in controlling the rotor operation. The cyclic pitch control causes a variation in the pitch of the rotor blades as they rotate about the cycle of the tip path plane. The purpose of this pitch changes in part to cause the rotor disc to tilt in the direction in which it is desired to make the helicopter move. When we consider only the aerodynamic effect of the blade, it would seem that when the pitch of the blade is high, the lift would be high and the blade would rise. Thus, if the blades had high pitch as they pass through one side of the rotor disc and low pitch as they pass through the other side of the disc, the side of the disc having the higher high pitch should rise and the side having the low pitch should fall. This would be true except for gyroscopic precision. Gyroscopic precision is caused by a combination of a spinning force and an applied acceleration force perpendicular to the spinning force. I am giving a figure. It's showing a drawing of a spinning disc that represents the main rotor of the of a helicopter. If the disc is spinning in the direction indicated by the arrow and a force is applied upward at F, capital F, the disc will precess, in bracket move, in the direction shown at capital P. Thus, if a force is applied perpendicular to the plane of rotation at one point near the rim, the precession will cause an upward force 90 degrees from the applied force in the direction of rotation. As a result of the foregoing principle, it is desired to cause the main rotor of a helicopter to lift in a particular direction. The applied force must be at an angular displacement of 90 degrees ahead of the desired direction of the disc. The required force is applied aerodynamically by changing the pitch of the blades through the cyclic pitch control. When the cyclic control is pushed forward, the blade at the left increases in pitch as the blade on the right decreases in pitch. The airplane and up force to the left hand side of the rotor disc, but the up movement takes place 90 degrees ahead of this in the direction of rotation. The movement is therefore at the rear of the rotor plane and the rotor tilts forward. This of course applies a forward thrust and causes the helicopter to move forward. This action is illustrated in this figure. Helicopter can be caused to move in any directions desired merely by moving the cyclic pitch control in the direction. In that direction, the main rotor tilts in the direction called for the control and the helicopter moves as directed If the control is in neutral, the helicopter will hover, that is, in the main stationary in the air. In a wind, the helicopter will drift in the direction in which the wind is blowing unless sufficient rotor thrust is applied to cancel the effect of the wind. Before a helicopter takes off and when the rotor is turning, centrifugal force is the main force acting on the rotor blades. At this time, the rotor blades are in a horizontal position. As the blade pitch is increased and powers are applied to the rotor, the lift of the blades increases and the helicopter rises. The lift force of the blade causes the blade tips to rise above the horizontal plane and rotate through a conical path. This effect is called coning of the rotor blade and is illustrated in this figure. Helicopter is equipped with an articulated rotor having flapping hinges. The blade remains straight as they assume the coning position. If the rotor does not have flapping hinges, as in a rigid or semi-rigid rotor, the blade's bend limited amount when the helicopter is in the flight. The coning of rotor produces what is known as the Coriolis effect, which occurs as the center of mass of the rotor moves closer to the center of rotation when the blade rises. An examination of this is shown in the figure which I will be giving you, which shows why the center of mass, that is small c below that there is a 1, small c, there is again a small 2, and then again a comma, small c, below that 3, moves toward the center of the rotor disc as the blade rises. Coriolis effect is the tendency of the rotor to increase the speed of rotation and the distance of the center of mass of each blade from the center of rotation decreases. A simple experiment can be used to demonstrate Coriolis effect. Attach a small weight, about 4 ounces or 0.1 kg to the end of the strong cord about 8 feet in bracket 2.4 meter in length. Now swing the weight at the end of the cord in a circle about the head at a speed that will keep the plane of the circle approximately horizontal. Count the number of the turns per minute required to keep the weight circling the horizontal plane. Perform the same experiment with the cord 4 feet in bracket 1.22 meter in length. It will be noted that the number of turns per minute is much greater with the shorter cord. The result of Coriolis effect on a rotor is an acceleration of the blade as they flap up and deceleration as they move downward. The direction of this acceleration and deceleration is parallel to the plane of the rotor disc. This movement is absorbed by the vertical drag hinges or dampers and structures of the blades. Two blade rotors that are underslung or semi-rigid are not greatly influenced by Coriolis effect. According to Newton's third law of motion, for every force, there is an equal and opposite force or reaction. The torque force applied to the rotor shaft of a helicopter to turn the rotor causes an equal and opposite torque force, which could turn the fuselage of the helicopter in the opposite direction unless measures were taken to prevent it. This is the function of the anti-torque rotor or tail rotor. The tail rotor effect is controlled through the pedals in the pilot compartment. Now, drift caused by the tail rotor. As mentioned previously, the tail rotor of the helicopter applies a force to oppose the torque caused by the main rotor. Since the main rotor turns to the left bracket counterclockwise as viewed from the top, the torque force causes the helicopter to turn to the right. Tail rotor force must therefore be applied to the right to keep the heading steady. The combined effect of the tail rotor thrust and the main rotor tug is to apply a net force that causes the helicopter to drift to the right. This drift is corrected by rigging the main rotor mast so that the main rotor will apply a force slightly to the left, or by design the cyclic pitch controls to provide a slight tilt of the tip path plane to the left. Now, ground effect. When a helicopter is hovering near the ground, the downward stream of air strikes the ground and does not escape from beneath the helicopter as rapidly as it is being driven toward the ground. This causes a buildup of air pressure below the helicopter, which act as a cushion to help support the machine in the hovering position. The ground cushion is usually effective to a height of approximately 1/2 the diameter of the main rotor while the helicopter is hovering. When the helicopter moves horizontally at 3 to 5 knots in bracket 1.54 to 2.57 meter per second, the ground cushion is left behind. Translational lift. When a helicopter is moving horizontally in flight at more than 15 knots, that is in bracket 7.7 meter per second, the performance of the main rotor improves owing to the increased volume of air passing through it. This effect is called translational lift. Because of the lift of the rotor increases, it is apparent therefore that less engine power is required to maintain flight wing. The helicopter is flying horizontally that when it is hovering. Now, transverse flow effect, a condition that must be compensated for the design and rigging of a helicopter is caused by the change in the velocity of the air as it flows across the main rotor disc at the tip path plane. The air at the near portion of the disc has greater velocity than the air at the forward portion, owing to acceleration of the air as it flows across and through the disc. The effect is to produce a greater volume of air through the rear portion of the disc than through the forward portion, and this produces a greater force upward and the rear of the disc. The effect, because of the precision, is to cause the rotor disc to tilt forward the left. This effect, called transverse flow effect, is corrected by the cyclic pitch system. Now, last but not least, here is auto rotation. The helicopter must incorporate a safety feature to provide for the condition that exists in the event of power failure. This feature is called auto rotation and is required before a helicopter can be certificated by the Federal Aviation Administration. If power failure occurs, the engine automatically disengages from the rotor system through a freewheeling device associated with the transmission. During auto rotation, the airflow is upward through the main rotor rather than downward, and this upward flow causes the rotor to turn in the same direction as in the normal operation. The turning of the rotor generates lift, which makes it possible to continue controlled flight while descending to a safe landing. If engine failure occurs, the pilot immediately lowers the collective pitch control, thus reducing the pitch of all rotor blades simultaneously. He also moves the cyclic pitch controls forward to establish the best forward speed of auto rotation. Each helicopter has a characteristic forward speed which produces maximum lift and lowest tilt of descent. During auto rotation, the outer 25% of the blade produces the lift, a section between 25% and 70% of the distance from the tip of the blade produces the driving force that keeps the rotor turning, and the inner 25% to 35% produces neither lift nor drive in any measurable degrees.